you really want to win the series, instead of blaming picks, let's talk about what we can fix. And even if you do think picks are problematic, you can say it in a much more productive way.
Yeah, I say fucking picks problem. Mm-hmm. They just fucking, I just play fucking normal game with voice chat with some random guys.
Why?
They just, after all game, they just do nothing. Oh, I do this, I do this. They just doesn't have any plan. They just fucking just shut. They don't know what to do. They just shut down.
If they don't know what to do, then we can help them in game.
Wait, how I fucking say five men?
I think saying something simple like, yo guys, I want to get side lane priority. Can you help? Can you push
them? It's a very good place to get back in and winning these team fights. And is Liquid just sort of playing like it's Chandra solo queue, saying, hey,
we practice really hard before Horse played, but in LCS state, I just feel like everyone just wanna lose and go home fast.
Surprisingly, in the last 4 years, we had never done a boot camp in Korea. So they went there and I had Loco spearhead the initiative and put together where the boot camp would be at, what teams are going to scrim, and what hotel would we stay at, what would the food situation be. Unfortunately, I wasn't able to fly to Korea. We were working on a very large partnership deal for Team Liquid that would have sizable impact on what 2017 would look like for the company. And that took priority over the boot camp. It was the first time where we did a boot camp where I wasn't close by with the team. Mistake number one. So I started to hear some of these problems and I tried to fix them remotely and it just kind of wasn't working.
Honestly, the Korea trip was a pretty big failure before we even arrived. Everyone was let down, but especially I was let down, so then that made me frustrated, and then eventually my frustration just kind of led to a blow up.
No, like you're playing it where you're just going through the motion and wasting your time instead of trying to win or instead of trying to recover. Like there's no talking about what we should do afterwards. There's no talking about how we're gonna win mid game. There's no talking about how we're gonna team fight. Like you're just jungling.
Yeah, that's my job. I'm a jungler.
It's so effortless. Like you're not shot calling. Shot calling also part of your job. Like talking to your teammates, that's also part of your job.
What was going to be a really productive boot camp and preparing during the off season between the two splits ended up turning into a complete behavioral disaster. There was a few blow ups between the players and Loco that had went so far that it was almost not repairable.
Swallow the pride, because I know you really, really want to fucking win. Like, there's times where
I mean, there's no pride. I already said, yeah, I made the mistake. It won't happen again. I don't know what else you want me to say. Well, you want me to get in my time machine and go back before the scrim started and play differently? Like, I'll try.
No, it's just how we deal with problems. When I made a mistake regarding pick and ban, I apologize and say, like, I'm sorry, like, and then we try to move on. Instead, like...
We went over the mistake, I saw that I was wrong, and I said, okay.
Yeah, you guys, why come here? You guys want practice, then you guys come here, right? So just blocking focus practice while blocking trolling. Even Joshi, you die, we still focus four people, but you always going there. And you always send me, you want fucking win summer split, then you should focus game.
Yeah, maybe not anymore.
Okay, then just don't practice.
Okay.
Most of these players, when they play in the West, they don't just play against the best team in their region. What they do is they play all the teams in the LCS, and they maybe sometimes when they can't get practice against LCS, they might play the odd challenger team in scrims. And so unfortunately, they are used to, first of all, having a decent win rate. Even a team who's like fifth or sixth in LCS, like Team Liquid, might be able to, in scrims, have a 60, 70% win rate. Maybe they win a pretty decent amount. If they go to Korea, the first week they get there, they're going to lose most of their scrims. And if they play the best teams, they're going to get destroyed where they have almost no chance to win. So that in itself destroys their confidence. And unfortunately, especially younger players, makes them think like, oh, not only am I not going to win now, but how could I ever win playing these teammates? Something has to be done right now. We have to fix it all. And even worse, the secondary aspect is when they are playing in the West and things go badly, they can still keep telling themselves, you know what? There's a lot we can still improve. As we keep playing more tournaments, we'll get better. Remember, last split was the first split for these rookies. Now when you go to Korea, you feel like, okay, right, no excuses. We're playing the best teams in the world. This is our best chance to get as good as we can get now. We're going to see what the ideal scenario is. Then when you lose, it feels like, well, what else can we do? I mean, there's no like, we can't go to the moon and play versus Martians to get better. Like, we just played the best players. We're in the ideal practice scenario, and we're doing even worse, and we're doing really badly, and all our problems are very apparent. That's going to come to an extreme head when you're in this scenario of a Korean boot camp. So that's why I think if you look in the past, the teams that have gone to Korean boot camps, who weren't really cohesive units and didn't have a very clear coaching philosophy and didn't have the star players and the role players in the right harmony and the right balance, they're the teams that get worse from the Korean boot camp because it just adds more pressure and unfortunately rips you apart at the seams from the few elements that were holding you together.
I think Josh is definitely an interesting personality to have on any team, like say Loco, Josh, or Piglet, because all three of those personalities are pretty similar. They want to voice their opinions, like they all just get mad at each other, and having a lot of big personalities on a team can just lead to a lot of conflict.
Being better than other players in the game doesn't give people right to like act like babies or shit on other people. And that's not just for you, like that's for me and that's for Josh, or that's even for Phoenix too. I'm sure like on SKT, like Faker probably has favoritism from Goma, and other people feel that way about me and you, and I still want to have like continuously good relationship with you, but I want it to be like a fair relationship between you and me and other people too. I think you should be more revered and you should have more say, but for that to happen, your play has to always be top notch, which you've been good with, but you're on. Mentality and your behavior towards things outside of the game also have to be good. Do you agree with the things said?
Maybe.
Maybe that's the best answer I'm going to get out of Josh and Piglet.
The way you treat us and the way you treat Piglet is completely different.
Okay, if you feel and that way, I'll try to make sure it's fair as possible.
Like there are facts on the table and everyone feels the same way about
okay,
it.
Okay, if you feel that way, then I'll try to change it so it's not that way.
Whatever, dude.
I mean, as you said, like, we're going to have different relationship with me and him and, like, me and you, and...
Yeah, and you're going to treat him like a baby that he is, and you're going to be hard on me because, yeah, I'm the actual one that's working hard to improve the things that I'm bad at.
That was a bit emotionally charged, but...
Well, I mean, historically, Piglet's been the same thing the whole time, no?
Yeah, it's...
I mean, has Piglet improved?
Yeah.
He has improved,
yeah.
So he's
improved, yeah, but, like... The root problem is still there, as you call them, root problems, and those don't seem to be going away anymore.
I don't think he's improved that much, though. Like, he spent an entire game not talking. That's
yeah, that game
impressive.
Was really bad.
Everyone had an idea of what we were going to do, but Piglet's idea was totally different.
don't know, he was just lazy. Like, we all went there and it's a boot camp, and that means we're gonna play all day. We're gonna try super hard and get ready for the next split and try to win it, because we were all like super let down from getting fourth. When we arrived, like, Piglet only played the game during scrim hours, and then like after scrim hours, he was out like with his girlfriend, with his friends and stuff, and like he was out every night like drinking with like Impact and Reaper and his Korean friends that were there too. So it was like really awful work ethic that we're not used to seeing Piglet have. And it frustrated me a lot, because I'm sitting there playing like 18 hours a day with a wrist injury, just like killing my wrist. And then I got some dude just like jerking off.
Okay. I'm just doesn't tell. I'm still try hard.
Okay, so from my definition of try hard is both in play and also in terms of how you guys talk. So I don't think you're trying hard when you're not talking, and I don't think Josh is trying hard when Josh is being passive.
How I can talk like?
Okay, let me finish and then we can go over what is it, like the little details of it. Like, there's times where Josh is actually like really helpful to you, and then he's like, yo, Piglet, you need to talk, like, what do you need, bottom? And then there's times where Josh is like, this is a fucking 4v5, like, there's no point to play this game, like, why are we fucking playing this? Can we just pause here? Like, so whenever Josh is like being emo, or Josh is being aggressive or passive aggressive, I can be like, yo, Josh, what the fuck are you doing? Like, why are you being passive aggressive? This isn't helpful. Like, I can try to be more understanding of like why he's having those problems and help him with those problems. And same thing for him to you, and then like you to Matt. Like, when Matt is having problems, you're like, I can't fucking play, like my support like doesn't know what to do in lane. Like, instead you can like, we can tell Matt how to play it better, and then we can be like supportive of him.
I'm still playing and I'm still trying my best and still communicating as well, but yeah, I can't lie, but this feels like a fucking waste of my time. And it's a waste of everyone's time if we're not going to try super hard as five, and only if only some of us are trying.
What do you need Piglet to say?
I mean, words. Like, he doesn't say a word all game. He said, like, I think, like, a total of, like, five words, maybe an incomplete sentence that whole game.
I think, like, Phoenix, Sam, and Matt overall weren't that problematic. And with Piglet, I spent a lot of one-on-one time, and we talked about why he shouldn't do certain stuff and how he should behave in certain ways. But he had his expectations set, and there was no way of really going about it. Piglet is pretty lonely in America. He doesn't have that many close friends. Only close friend I could really think of would be Impact and Phoenix. And because Phoenix got a girlfriend about like last split or two splits ago, him and Phoenix have been pretty distant. And then also Impact used to live with NRG, and NRG was really far from us. So Piglet actually didn't have a lot of close friends, and he was really lonely. And he spent a lot of time just on Skype with his girlfriend whenever we were done with scrims, and he needed to be more incorporated with the team, and he didn't connect that well with the players because they were much younger than him, and also the culture is really different. So the only people that he could really like socialize with were me and David. And in spring split, our schedule was pretty intense. So on Sundays, I would take time off, and sometimes he would hang out with David, and sometimes David would take time off, so he was really lonely. So when he went to Korea and he had a lot of opportunities to see his friends, see his girlfriend, he took a lot of them. So I would say during games itself, his motivation was really high, but outside of practice, his motivation wasn't high as it could be.
저랑 피닉스랑 쌤이랑 메시랑은 솔직히 전혀 문제가 없었는데 그냥 정글러랑 문제가 너무 많았어요. 그냥 계속 너무 싸우고 멘탈도 계속 깨져서 연습도 잘 안 되고 그래서 계속 그냥 스크림을 하다가 그냥 뭐 팀이 좀 너무 안 돼가지고 다른 정글러도 끼면서 게임도 하고 근데 다른 정글러를 끼면서 하니 게임을 하니까 더 그냥 성적이 더 잘 나왔었어요. 그래서 그냥 이 편하다라고 생각했었어요.
Wait, I left my phone downstairs and I was hoping Piglet had more.
Instead of actually getting ready.
Actually really responsible.
Team이고
팀메이트고 그러면은 당연히 이제 그 아이랑 제일 친해져야 되는 건 당연한 거고 왜냐하면 팀 성적이 잘 나와야 되니까 그래서 근데 이게 저한테도 너무 힘들었고 뭐 팀한테도 너무 힘들었을 거예요 너무 말도 들으려고도 안 하고 고치려고도 노력도 안 해가지고 좀 가까이 하기가 너무 힘든 애였던 것 같아요.
Start off about Korea. I definitely loved Korea. Just being in Korea, all of the solo queue I played, all of the food I ate, all of the things that I did in Korea was just amazing. But then there was a lot of like flares sparking. I think there was a lot of friction getting built up because of the sort of arguments that were happening. And I think the way that as a team that we handled it was not good because it ended up causing a bunch of really just a lot of unnecessary conflicts that really just built up over the entire boot camp. I don't know, I've never really been the one to try to really relate with those kinds of personalities. They seem really out of my comfort zone. So when I like confront like Loco or like Dardoch or maybe even Piglet, those kinds of personalities are not really what I was used to. So dealing with it, kind of just avoided confrontation. Just kind of just hoping everything would just ride along smoothly. And that caused me to have a lot of regrets.
I'm saying from my perspective. I mean, you can ask other people's opinions if you don't want to.
People should just be more open about calling each other out and like deal with the bullshit. Like,
I mean, I got to deal with myself first. Like, after I deal with myself, then sure, I can call other people out.
I mean, what about you guys?
Like, I think it's just the coach's responsibility, because I can't...
No, it's not just the coach.
Well, no, because I can't call out Dardoch's bullshit or Piglet's bullshit if I have my own bullshit. I have to, like... Everybody has to fix themselves before they fix someone else's. But you're the coach. I mean, I guess at some point, if you have to...
People don't help each... If we wait for everyone to be perfect and only perfect people can help other people, then, like, that creates... this system where if you're better at the game, you can just shit on people that are worse than you at the game, and then people that are worse than you at the game just get treated like garbage.
For me, I think confidence-wise, I kind of just go up and down. Like, it's a really roller coaster effect. Sometimes I'm really confident. Like, I don't care what anybody says. I just think I'm like the best player ever. But other times, I feel like I'm just a worthless player and I have nothing to contribute. And that like sort of emotional roller coaster is like really bad when you're in a like an environment where you're expected to be consistent, like everything's supposed to be constant.
We should be practicing on teamwork. That's like, that happens one of the 20 games.
Yeah,
because like, we have internal problems.
I agree. Why did I like respect?
And
so much?
We
like
need to find there, success right? to improve our internal problems, but that comes from improving our gameplay, which comes from the 1 in 20 games that we actually study review and get better as a team.
I think it comes from people being like, my feelings don't matter as much as the team success, so I'll shut up.
Yeah, but nobody's like that because we're not normal people. We're all people with not exactly normal mental states, and like we're all different people with very.
So you think people are incapable, or people?
It's not incapable. It's just harder. Yeah, like it's definitely a choice, but it's not an easy choice.
If it was easy, then every team would have good teamwork. No, it's the teams that decide my teamwork and my team success is more important than my personal feelings. Or every team would have good teamwork.
Yeah, but there's also things that makes it unnecessarily harder that could be easily fixed.
I think every team has that. It's up to individuals to make their own choice.
Matt always struggled with being a player and putting a lot of work into being a player. And Matt was someone that succeeded in a lot of ways, not by his own talent when he was playing with Piglet, because Piglet was just extremely good. And Matt's performance suddenly dipped. And a lot of the confidence and the ego he got to build with that suddenly was unmet. And he was, I guess, like, he had like a reality shock. And he was questioning a lot of the plays that he did, a lot of the directions that was taken with the team, because I believe like you should have the best fundamentals, the best basic, and you should constantly put work into that.
Regarding what Pika needs to say to you, like if I say be specific and then you say friendly environment, it's really hard to help too. Like I can't just tell Pika be friendly, but if you tell me specifically, yo Pika, I need you to say these things, this things, it helps me when you say this thing, then I can tell that directly to Piglet. And whenever he doesn't do that, I can be like, oh, you didn't do this. But if you just say, be friendly, I can't be like, yo, Piglet, why weren't you friendly this game? Because I don't know directly
what
you
want. Well, I mean, the solution to that would be like, we actually have to be friends. Like, that's like a solution. It's not just like, just say friendly things.
Okay, what do you want in terms of
being friendly? I mean, you see how like CLG is like a very like friendly environment. They're like very teamwork driven. And they got second in MSI, and like, yeah, like I've talked to you before, like how CLG's environment is ideal for people to improve, and like for Team Liquid, it's like very results driven. Like if we're not winning scrims, like it's a bad scrim, and it's like the opposite for CLG. Like if they're losing scrims, it's still a productive scrim. And I thought that was like an optimal way to run like scrims and like have practice. And I think the key to that would be a friendly environment, being friends with all your teammates, and. Yeah, that's something that I've asked before, like, you should probably work on.
Okay, how do you want to work on it?
I mean, to be honest, I don't have the answer, but a good start would be to, yeah, try and be friends, I guess.
Okay, so whenever I suggest things like, let's go do this, or let's go do this, or let's go do this, or in the past where I brought up, what are the people being friends with each other, you say stuff like, I don't think I can ever be friends with this person. I don't think I can ever be friends with this person. This personality is too different. I don't think I can do things with this person.
Yeah, it's hard for me to see that, but I mean, that's like what it takes to be a good team, I think.
So I like try to facilitate that and then try to get that going, but various people complain about, I can't be friends with this person, and they won't put the first foot forward, then it's hard to facilitate that at all, and I think you're part of that.
I mean, I'm asking you to fix a problem I don't know how to fix, and I guess it's hard for you to fix it yourself, so I don't know.
You're right, and exactly right there. He's saying something to reply to like what you just said, and you just look at him bare in the face, close your eyes, and roll your eyes. Like, that is so disrespectful, and yeah, like, how do you think that makes, like, yeah, I mean, yeah, just straight up, you don't take into, like, players' feelings at all with anything you do as a coach. Like, me and Piglet, for example, we can take the harsh criticism that you give because, yeah, we have thick skin, but, like, all of us aren't going to have thick skin, and the way that you, like, treat Matt and Sam is, like, yeah, that's fucking bullshit, dude.
But you did it.
You treat Sam just as even worse than me, and then you say it's fine because of the relationship, and then Matt and Sam both separately on occasions told me, I want you to be straight up with me, and then just give the criticism and the comments. And then so I do exactly what's asked, and then you say how I treat Matt and Sam is disgusting, but you treat Sam worse.
How is rolling your eyes in his face while he's trying to make his point, giving direct criticism? What does he get from you rolling your eyes?
Also, you still give the point straight up without, by respecting their feelings while you're giving them, like, it could be friendly. That's like the whole point of this. Like,
I want to be friendly, but if he make the same mistakes over and over again, like, don't complain about things, don't do this, don't do this, and then we consistently do it, like, it's hard for me to, like, care about you guys.
Like,
you contradict yourself all the time. Like, just now, you're using, when you bring up a fault on yourself, you bring up someone else's fault, which in this case was mine, instead of admitting your own fault and then trying to fix it.
It's hard for me.
Let me finish. And
okay,
also,
finish.
You also just made excuses for yourself on top of it, which you tell Matt and others not to do all the time.
Okay, my bad.
Perfect.
And then you're being sarcastic instead of trying to solve problems.
No, I literally have been trying to problem solve this whole time with a positive attitude towards this whole situation.
Okay.
And I said perfect because you answered correctly and you moved on productively.
Cool.
Thank you, Loco.
Alright, so anyways, regarding problems, if you're not going to be specific about things, and if you don't do the things I ask, I can't, it's like really hard for me to help you.
Okay, I guess I just didn't know your perspective of it.
Okay.
Oh, I've noticed Matt getting down on himself a ton of times. There's just a lot of things where Matt's sort of in the same position as me, where if he sort of fails now or falters in his career, then he's got nothing to look back to, because I don't know if he dropped out of high school, but I did. So I definitely understand the feeling he has, where he feels like, I've talked to Matt separately and I know he's said this in front of everybody before, where he knows he's underperforming and he feels like he's not an LCS level player.
but he's got nothing else to do. So he's got no choice then to feel like he's bringing his team down, but show up every day because he's got no other options. You know what I mean? So yeah, I understand where Matt's coming from, and I wouldn't wish that kind of feeling on any player ever in league. Oh no, it was extremely volatile, Korea, in the scrim room. But outside of the scrim room, we all loved each other. It was awesome. Like going out, and I mean, I've always loved Piglet like a brother, and I've always had a ton of respect for him as a player. But I mean, nobody's ever themselves when they're frustrated or upset. You know what I mean? Like, there's a lot of things people say that they regret when they say I'm angry or whatever it may be, and I'm the same way. Like, there's a lot of things I've said during scrims where I'm just like, yeah, there's no way I'm wrong on this, where it's just my ego talking, and it's like, yeah, obviously I'm wrong. Like, I come back to it, like, it was a cycle where it would be like our egos would go at it in the AM, and then we'd be like, all right, let's go out for dinner, and then we'd go out for dinner and like, oh, my bad today, dude, like, sorry. But I mean, we were still ego heads the day after, and nothing changed.
Over the course of this 36-minute game, I didn't talk for 20 seconds straight. Damn, I really checked out, dude.
And then
really
now you're being, what is it? This is what you do when you're checked out and when I call you out.
Ooh, I'm checked out of real life, too. Fuck, you got me, dude.
I mean, yeah.
That's insane.
You're being sarcastic. That's exactly what you do.
Yeah, because it's fucking dumb, dude. Like, what the fuck?
It's what you do when you disagree. You become sarcastic because you have nothing logical to say about it.
I mean, I checked out for 20 minutes during this, 20 seconds during this 36-minute game. I wouldn't account that to checking out during the whole game, like you said. Like, you talk about me speaking in absolutes, you spoke in an absolute in this example. You checked out this game. So I checked out all 36 minutes of this game. I don't think that's accurate at all, Loco.
I made a mistake. Because you can't be called out on a mistake without fighting back,
I mean,
about it.
Yeah, because I didn't check out this game. I tried fucking hard, and I
ask
got...
Ask Piglet, ask Matt, ask the rest of the team.
I mean, Zig thinks I didn't check out.
Okay, Piglet and Matt did.
Okay, well, that's 2-3. I still think that's not very good odds for you. I don't
it's
think
three
that...
3-2, and also with coaching staff. You just argued...
Coaching staff as in yourself.
Yeah, coaching staff as in myself, as in the person you said you would just listen to.
Yeah, but I'm not listening to bullshit.
Because you don't agree with it, it's bullshit.
Yeah, because I didn't check out this game. Like, no one's going to know who checked out more than myself, dude.
Bullshit, Matt thinks it's bullshit. Me telling you can't joke around, like, you think it's bullshit
no,
when I tell you you shouldn't...
It's different, dude. Like, if anyone checked out that game, it was 100% Samson, and you haven't said a fucking word to him.
What do you mean I haven't said a fucking word to him? Like,
you said,
you're
like,
using
oh, yeah,
absolutes
Sam,
again,
out.
Where you, like, you become hella emotional and you use absolutes. The first thing I called out was Sam and you guys checking out a game. I called both of you guys out. What do you mean I haven't
yeah,
said a word to Sam?
Yeah,
harping
on me only. Like, what?
But Sam just
out.
Agrees, and Sam's like, okay, yeah, I was checked out, so there's nothing more to go over. But you disagree about you checking out. That's why I harp on you.
Okay, I agree, Loco. I'm agreeing with Loco.
I disagree with Loco 100%. I think it's absolute bullshit. Everything coming out of his mouth came from the ass first.
You can't take criticism at all.
I take criticism just fine when it's actual criticism. Like, because
you don't get to be the one that decides the actual criticism.
When I'm actually wrong and in the wrong and I make mistakes, I admit it 100%, dude.
This is the direct cause of so rate of improvement. Like, I thought we already talked over this. You just listened to the coach.
Yeah, but if that game happens in LCS, I'm going to talk the same amount, 100%, because that was my role in the team. Like, my role wasn't to be a shot caller that game. It was to be an aide. And whether you agree or disagree, like, that's up to you, but I know what my champion does and what my role in the team was that game. Sorry.
I mean, the big problem I see with this is, like, as I've kind of outlined, to me, unfortunately, if you're the owner and you're having problems with a player's attitude, what's unfortunate about this specific instance of Dardoch is he is literally the most valuable player in the Team Liquid organization for League of Legends, because he's a star player. He's at a position where there are very few star players in LCS, And even worse, he's a native North American player, and therefore he doesn't need a visa situation, and also he doesn't need import slot. So as a result, he is literally the most valuable player in your League of Legends team within your organization. So the big issue for me is, not only do you have to kind of make decisions that take you down a path where the end result is he's always in the team and something changes, but he's always in the team, whether that be a different coach or working with him in a different way, he's always in the team. The big problem to me is you can never have leverage over that player for the reasons I've outlined, because ultimately that will make them incredibly valuable to other teams. So one of the big problems with working with Dardoch is deep down, Dardoch must have known for the entire split, if things don't go my way, if I don't like the way this coach deals with me, if I don't like the way our team does and we don't succeed, at the end of it all, I have the ultimate option, which is stop trying to fix all this, just leave, go to another team. To me, the big problem is that had to have been in the back of Dardoch's mind the whole time. And that's why, unfortunately, the decisions that were made, I feel like it's not that they were all wrong, it's just that they led to a place where eventually he could leave or would be have to be removed.
Our secondary team was expected to be competitive, expected to try to make LCS, expected to try to win Challenger, while at the same time, every single move seemingly for Spring Split was to help the main team thrive. My name is David Lim, and I was the head coach of Team Liquid Academy while helping out with the Team Liquid LCS team whenever I could. Dardoch and Matt, two of the primary players supporting jungle, were taken from them, and then we didn't have many options because Dom wanted to retire. It really deterred from Team Liquid Academy's spring progress.
Taking over for I Will Dominate is Dardoch in the jungle.
Dardoch started to develop a reputation because he deserved one. He was playing really well, and because of that, he put more expectation on himself. With that expectation comes, eventually, if your teammates are failing you, burden. It became hard for him to see through those mistakes. But in spring, especially after the CLG loss.
Yeah, this game.
They're gonna take Dragon first.
Oh, that was just TP!
It's two of them, the double TP!
He only thought it was one. He had to have only thought it was one.
Yeah, I'm disappointed that we're stuck to either get third or fourth, but yeah, better than our expectations at the beginning of the split, I suppose.
When you're not competing for a championship and you're competing for third, fourth, it's a completely different dynamic.
Who would you actually rather face between TSM and Immortals?
I don't have a preference of TSM Immortals. We're gonna smash whoever we get against. We're not gonna slow down for practice just because it's like a less valuable match or anything. We're just gonna meet whoever we play against, beat them, and then move on to next split.
I can tell he really wanted to win, but he wanted to win without hassle, and it showed.
When you're an employee of a company, there's a certain way that you need to behave. And you know, Josh is, he's young, right? And he's still learning. You can't harass somebody and then have no consequences associated with it. So at the time, we decided, all right, well, let's document every single thing that he has done. And at the same time, let's also take a look at the coaching staff and the organization and look at the things that we have contributed as well. And let's list all of them out. There needed to be consequences with Josh for his actions, and he needed to understand that you can't behave that way. So we suspended him at that time, and the suspension lasted for 2 weeks on the calendar date, and we had to make a decision on whether or not we would use him going into LCS or not.
With your behavior, the way that you compete as an athlete. One of the things that I think is an issue is your self-awareness, you know, like your ability to recognize what you're doing and then control your emotions. You just kind of act as you feel. And that's a sign of immaturity. You just act however you feel. There's no thought to it. It's just all reactionary based. When this happens, then things escalate. really fast.
I know my role. Better than anyone in this organization, I know my role. Mm-hmm. And I will stand by that 100%.
Okay, so.
Yeah, I mean, you tell me a bunch of shit.
And you say you don't
right,
care.
I separate the issue. Yeah. You guys can't keep doing this back and forth bullshit. Like, I'm gonna just cut it off right now. This is just us listing issues. If you guys are gonna do the back and forth thing, you guys need to, like, take a minute to step out and cool down. Because that can't happen if we're gonna have a productive meeting.
All right.
Like, I don't want you to come in and go, oh, can I counter-argue? I don't want you to argue with points that are being made, even if you want to try to dispute and prove your side. That's not the time for this room.
I'll actually take that.
Even now, Loco's... He's obviously upset, like he's fucking spam flicking his lighter, he's like having to step out every 5 seconds because he's mad. Like, this isn't a productive argument either way. Like, he's obviously upset and it's like really like pissing me off.
Okay, so what I'd recommend is let's just take a break, and we'll just pick up tomorrow on stuff. This is like a work in progress. Not gonna solve everything.
Can you
go sit with Dardoch for a little bit and just like make sure he's cool and, hey, just want to see how things are going, you know.
I'm telling you, Loco, the way that you did that was sending a non-verbal message to everyone in the room. Yes. Just wait a second. The non-verbal communication can be as strong, if not stronger, than what you actually say, okay? And you were communicating based on how you did that. I'm mad, I'm frustrated, fuck Dardoch, I don't like this. All these things that you were saying, just based on how you acted. Mm-hmm. And did you feel the same thing?
Yes, it was really obvious.
It's really, but no, I'm saying the non-verbal communication sent that message to you in your head. It also sent that message to Dardoch. So it's how you carry yourself. So instead of, let's say, Nick, I think we should all step out of the room, you should be like, Nick, good idea. Why don't we all just take a break? I gotta piss. Let me step out real fast, guys. Just kind of regroup. Okay. And you make eye contact with everybody. You look at Dardoch, like, cool, is it okay if I step out? And then you step out. That would have sent the message like, oh, I appreciate the suggestion about going stepping out. I am not mad. I am in control of my emotions. That's not what happened. And here's my advice, is that this is an area where you need to develop. Like, you have a problem with almost like Dardoch. It's kind of funny that way, where you just show your emotions very quickly sleeve.
From my point of view, like, I thought he was gonna cry, so no one told me to. I was like, oh shit, he's gonna cry, and like, I don't want it to be like a fucking mess. So I went and got him toilet paper, like, look right behind you, like, I don't want it to, like, make a mess of himself, and, like, I still care, like, so make sure, like, you're not crying on yourself.
Your perception's off. Okay, in this instance it is. Your intentions are good.
Your intentions are good.
Your intentions are great. We don't need to dig into it anymore. All I'm saying is that when we've talked about, it's so funny how, like, some of the things are so similar, but about being more self-aware of what is going on, it requires people that care about you, like me, and to give you feedback so that you can develop. And it's not about judging, it's literally so that we can work together in a better way. Just think more that your communication is not just what you said. It's how you act, it's fidgeting, like that, you know? It is, it's a lot of that stuff. Okay. You know, everything is sending a message.
Okay.
Just be more thoughtful about what you're communicating, even if you're not talking. And so the decision was, you know what, Moon is hungry. He really wants to play in LCS. He's been playing really well in Challenger. Why not give him a shot? Let's see what he has, you know, to offer. A lot of rookies step up, and I have absolutely no problem giving someone that's really hungry, that works really hard, that's proved results, an opportunity to prove themselves. Especially when the counterpart to that position is acting more entitled. So for me, it was a pretty easy conclusion that, yes, let's give Moon a shot.
From what I've heard, it's like mainly Dardoch. I'm hearing a lot of it is like attitude and communication problems. It's never perfect. Like, every team has its problems. I'm Galen Moon Holgate, and I'm the jungler for Team Liquid. Our team chemistry on TLA is amazing. Like, everyone is so funny. We're just like all really close, and it just feels like I fit in perfectly here. I just expect TLA to make LCS. That's what everyone's in it for. If it's any less than that, then it's a disappointment. Since I won't have that much time with the new roster and playing with the main team, for the first 3 weeks of LCS, it'll mainly just be us gelling, me like figuring out the playstyle, figuring out how to communicate with everybody. But I definitely expect us to be a really strong team going into the split.
The problem with removing Dardoch to me over removing Piglet is I don't see what the future of the main Team Liquid team is if you remove Dardoch. Like, are you just gonna bring him back later when his attitude's been readjusted, that like fucking crazy Orwellian term that people use nowadays? In that scenario, I don't see it happening. Like, I don't see why he would then come back later from another team and suddenly be great and you're gonna insert him again. So you are essentially giving up him being on that team. Like, okay, what's the best case scenario? He goes to the Challenger team, wins Challenger, and then you have to sell the team and therefore he's not on your organization anymore. Or you just bring him back into the main team and you just avoided the problem of resolving him and Piglet for a split. So in that scenario, I think Team Liquid as a team would actually be worse if you removed Dardoch entirely and just had Moon play for the whole split. I don't think it would have been as good. What's funny about this whole scenario is, I really wonder if after all of this, both of these players and Lokodokuru as well, really can't look at it and in hindsight realize, oh, actually, we kind of really need that Dardoch guy as a jungler. Probably is a better investment of our time and effort than trying to find someone else who can play that role. To me, it's like rather than try and fix one problem, you try to fix multiple problems at once and in different directions. It's not really a way to look at it. And like, there's no real reason on paper as to why that would work to me.
We have a two-time defending champion, three new teams, a new best of three format, and an all-new battle theater. The fight for Worlds is on, and the North American LCS Summer Split starts right now.
On stage, the biggest tools you guys have is each other, and the communication needs to be fucking strong, okay? We're a new team, in a sense, because we have a new jungler, and jungle is a huge fucking part of how we play the game, and so the information flow has to be there, okay? I want everyone to fucking talk. I know we play really well in LCS, and I know we're in a fucking rocket.
Is none other than Sam, Toby, Hartman, Kensler. How you doing, dude?
Great. How are you?
I'm doing pretty fast.
Back in the big stage.
Yeah, we're in the big stage today for this next one, but we're continuing our day of action
with newcomers Team Envy taking on Team Liquid. Now, Liquid is coming into this summer split after a top four finish, but we know these guys expected more, and they'll be coming into this summer ready to play.
Piglet and Phoenix, they had a great split last split. They were top performers. And Liquid, they're going to be looking to have those two veterans bring the consistency from last split. But something that won't be consistent is going to be the jungler. You know, there's a big question surrounding Liquid, how they are going to adapt losing Dardoch. That guy was such a big part of their resurgence last split. Him and Matt together were a shot calling combo, but he's not with the squad now. Stepping in as Liquid's jungler is going to be Moon, who actually struggled to find success last split on energy, but this team seems confident that Moon has improved.
Yeah, he does have at least two games to impress, so we'll see if he will be able to show us that. He's going to get onto this inhibitor. Lurlo has the convergence drop. Moon pulls the trigger. He gets into the back. Seraph in the front. It's Piglet trying to shred through. Moon goes low. He's finally going to drop the procs, and 5v4 are facing loss. If they turn this around, they can't do it.
And it's Envy who drops the Nexus and takes game number one. And they found Piglet. He's dead too.
They might just try to end the game right here. Moon gets caught and drops the rest, but Envy are not satisfied with just the inhib. They want the Nexus.
And they do claim their second series victory here. Undefeated.
We're a really, really fucking good team last split because we put in so much effort and we worked together as a unit. Like, that's what made us good. So today what I want to see is I want to see everyone just doing their fucking job. We gave each other individual roles, so we can rely on people to do their job and work together as a unit, and that's what I want to see. And I want to see people doing their job, and if someone's not doing their job, I don't want to hear blame. I want to hear people saying, yo, yo, it's fine, you can still do this, and I want us to work as a team.
Sweep one, Matt's playing against
the
definitely looks like communication is breaking down a little bit, missing that leader in the jungle, and Liquid seems uncoordinated currently. But they're not in the right place. Piglet, he commented before the split that he would never beat a Korean team with foreign teammates, and that's a bad mentality to have.
The bubble is low. He's going to either choose to heal or bubble on this. Biofrost is low. The kill from Piglet goes over to double it for first blood. And Biofrost flashes in this instant, thinking he could save himself. But teleports down.
Wait, Moon's walking up.
Why would Moon walk up?
He doesn't think Bjergsen has the damage at that point.
With the back line right now, Phoenix looks like he gets taken down, scrambled up once again. Lorlo tries to stay on the front line to mitigate some of that damage with his ultimate, but it's not going to be enough.
TSM will look to take game one of the series over Team Liquid.
And I think why we're losing is Moon's fault. Primarily. Could he be playing better? Of course. Is it his fault solely alone? No.
We wanted to give Moon an opportunity to prove himself, and unfortunately, Moon did not prove himself. You know, can Moon improve? Can he kind of get out of this? Of course. But in sports, you don't have the luxury of time. It was a large, intense, consultative mediation process that the organization invested into improving Dardoch, and he was responsive to that. So at that point, we said, look, let's get Josh back in there and let's see what this guy's got to, you know, got to prove.
That pushed Liquid to the brink, so Liquid are now making adjustments. They will sub in Dardoch for game two. The question is, will this change Liquid's fortunes? Because that seems a little bit like desperation there if they're subbing him in, even though they had suspended him.
Oh yeah, after the Korean thing where I was implicated back in the team because they would have gotten relegated without me. They made me promise to like do everything. Like we had agreements, like there are things Loco wanted to see from me, I wanted to see from him. We played nice and then we went back to normal pretty much.
They want any chance, but so is Hanser.
I'm singing this. We're fine. We can do this. Go Rek'Sai,
Go on Lucian, actually.
Come on Lucian.
Yeah, we're good.
I can win this.
If one of us talks.
Coming. I think Bard might be there before me because he has portal.
Phoenix with the flash this time.
Careful, portal.
Juan is here.
I'm coming mid.
I'm going down.
Kill Rek'Sai, just kill Rek'Sai. Turret. I'm here.
Oh, yeah, Bard. Hold on.
AD flash. Lucian. My bad.
Fuck,
we should have killed Turret. My bad.
Puts them down in the ground. Lorlo will be the next one. Biofrost trying to get on the other side of the mini.
Alright, fight of a lifetime, baby.
They're still going strong. They're still going with smiles on their faces, and they're going on to the Nexus. TSM will be 2-0 in the first week of the NALCS.
I think people thought there were easy solutions. People thought, oh, if we just take Dardoch out for a little while and bench him, that'll teach him a lesson, and he'll really see how, when we bring in this other jungler, we work better. Oh shit, yeah, we're way worse with that guy. Please, Dardoch, come back. So then that has accomplished nothing.
We'll be seeing Liquid in action in our first series, and we have to talk about Dardoch returning to the lineup here and what that means for Liquid.
Well, I love the storyline behind all this. You got a bad boy jungler who's really talented, but gets benched from Attitude, and then he has to get brought back just from his sheer skill, and now he has to make sure that he can bring the team together back and make these guys work. And to be honest, in that last game that they played last week, it looked like the entire team and not him was shaky. So
we benched Moon back to the TLA to bring Dardoch back to carry our team.
They know he can't stop the flash on Burrow, and they know his ultimate is already down a little bit.
So here we go, Dardoch's in, flash on Burrow is good, Lorlo dives in under the turret, and it's first blood Corellia, they're under the turret for Dardoch, more than enough health.
He was probably thinking, all right, I can carry this team, I can lead this team.
Ulti's way back in, Aphrodite will be forced to flash out, Nexus turret number two does melt, the Nexus will fall, and Team Liquid, a convincing game number one.
And as things were falling apart, he couldn't control his emotions, and he had really bad comms where he was giving up really early, he was saying, oh, we fucking lost, we can't win this game, what the fuck, oh, what are we doing?
Just fucking do Baron or some shit, dude. I want to go to the next game already.
This shit is so fucking pointless. What the hell? I just want to play the next one.
And that was like the final nail in the coffin. I think Piglet told me, real talk, that some of his bad SKT days, there was teammates of his saying that kind of stuff, and that's why he wanted to leave that team. And he didn't want to hear it anymore. And when it's a game day, no matter what, we should be playing to win, no matter what circumstances, and you shouldn't be giving up.
Oh, I fucking saw us, dude. I'm hitting sway, dude.
Alright, we're fucking out there.
That was like the real tipping point for Piglet, I'd imagine, because I mean, I was feeling pretty tilted off that, how Dardoch on LCS stage was saying, okay, we'll just fucking give up. I was like, what? Why would you say let's give up on LCS stage? And then Piglet probably tilted the hell out of, like, just off the face of the earth.
Just try and fucking take their KDAs or some shit, dude.
Take their KDAs.
Get in there, Samson.
This is my Maokai KDA.
Bye, Piggy.
He gave up in Piglet's sights, and Piglet viewed that as very, very disrespectful towards him and the rest of the team. So he, like, I think that's when, like, of trigger flipped, and he was like, oh, I'm no longer willing to work with Dardoch.
Can they end yet or what? God damn. Yeah, this one's a bit over, boys. Do we get it over with, or do you guys want to keep playing?
Just let them get...
Let them, okay. Yeah. Just keep pushing.
When Piglet was playing on the main team, the conflict and between Piglet and Josh was pretty high.
We decided to move Piglet down to TLA and move Fabi up to the main team.
It was a mixture of Piglet wanting a week break.
He's never had stage experience, so we wanted to give that to him because he asked for it.
We had a pretty easy week, so we were just like, all right, just throw Fabi in.
He had been working really hard, honestly, on TLA, and we thought he deserved the chance. And situationally, with Piglet feeling a little burnt out, we wanted to give him kind of like a mental break.
Dardoch and Piglet really didn't get along too well.
I don't know who we heard that from. Piglet, we had issues on the team, like always, and Piglet wanted a break, so we gave him a week to play on TLA.
They didn't agree on whether or not the game should be played around like top or bottom. Dardoch thought it was like a top-centric meta at the time, and Piglet thought it was a bot-centric meta. And then they couldn't ever like reach an agreement.
Josh would do something that would anger Piglet, and then Piglet would do something that would anger Josh, and it got to the point where we would try to work on the issue, we would try to resolve it, talk through it, have them express themselves, you know, and it just wasn't working. They just kept butting heads over and over and over and over.
TLA did have much more of a team cohesiveness, and I think Piglet saw that from the outside and said, well, I want to check that out. And Fabi wanting stage experience kind of worked out in that sense.
그거는 전혀 아니고 그냥 제가 너무 쉬고 싶어서 좀 너무 힘들어가지고 좀 그냥 쉬고 싶어서 그렇게 했던 거고 그리고 좀 제가 없을 때 좀 느끼는 게 좀 있었으면 좋겠다라고 생각을 했었어요. 왜냐하면 그래도 느끼는 게 있으면은 잘해줄 수 있으니까 저랑 다시 근데 그 느끼는 게 없으면은 좀 힘들겠다라고 생각을 했어요.
Instead of running two teams that were kind of helping each other and that you could move the roster back and forth, I was running two completely different teams and they weren't helping each other. They were actually competing with one another and I had to make each team as good as possible. The other four players that were on Team Liquid Academy really wanted to play with Piglet. And on the other hand, we had a lot of issues between Piglet and Dardoch on the main team. I thought, okay, well, what if Piglet were to play for Team Liquid Academy? How would he feel about that? So we spent 3 or 4 days and we had Piglet playing with the team and he loved it. Like, he was just elated. He was like communicating more. The other four players loved him. He was super happy. His mood went up. He was just enjoying life. Like, you could just tell in his behavior. I would ask him, hey, Piglet, how's things going? He's like, they're amazing. I love it here. I love playing for this team. Like, teammates just look up to me and we're winning and this is just fun. And I want to go back to what's being fun.
the alternative was, okay, well then why don't we move Fabi up to play for LCS? And leading into that decision, Fabi was just decimating in NACS. Like, if you go back and watch the matches in NACS where Fabi was playing before we did the switch, his KDAs and how he was carrying the games was just unreal. So it was kind of like, well, we're still getting a really damn good AD carry for the LCS team, and Piglet's enjoying the NACS team. So it was a logical choice. We were able to combat the conflict between Dardoch and Piglet. Piglet was happy, the main team was happy because Fabi was playing really well and his trajectory was way up. So at the time, it seemed like, yep, that's the logical solution, let's go with that.
So when I worked with Fabi on TLA, he had a lot of motivation, he had a lot of drive, and he was actually a really good player. And I thought he would do decently well, and I thought at first he did this do decently well.
Ask questions and talk to your teammates, okay? Don't assume stuff, and if you're not getting something done, talk to each other. Yo guys, we need to come here. Yo guys, what do you want to do? Yo guys, what lane setup we need to be? Like, if you're not in sync, it's because you guys...
Like in Challenger, I was like, either I carry or we lose. But like now it's like, I'm not gonna carry, but I'm gonna make sure Phoenix carries or Sam carries or even Dardoch carries. Like I'll make sure they carry by playing, you know, utility style where I play to help my teammates rather than I play for my own, like, you know, sake. I'm not gonna be farming bot all game, trying to scale up. I'm gonna be grouping up more, looking for picks with my teammates, moving around the map with them, giving up farm for that. And that's like sort of my style right now.
Story coming out of Liquid tonight has to be the substitution of Liquid Academy player Fabi in for Piglet at AD carry. Not yourself, or somebody else. It heals them, but he's gonna need something more. Tyrion, he's knocked out from the turret, flashes over the wall, takes a lot, and Fabi gets the kill. Gate gets knocked up, and he's destroyed. Team Liquid are going to break the base and try to end this game, taking a quick 2-0 over Phoenix One.
Yeah, 26 minutes in, these games are kicked up.
Quickly, Dardoch walled off once again. Pops guilty and runs north of Phoenix over the wall. They want this fight, actually, and it's going to be him zoning out OQ, who's actually surviving reasonably well, has a Hexbreaker. But look at Kiwi Kid, he's already going to be going down, and the Egg Pop, it's 2 kills, it's 3 kills, it's Liquid killing absolutely everybody, and 2 more autos will do it. That will be the game, that will be the series. Liquid improved to 3-3.
Before Apex can respond, Morlow tanking in the front.
Phoenix hops in, but the Nexus is already dead, and Team Liquid 2-0 Apex.
Takes him out, the ult is close, Polymelter flashes in and gets on with the Chaos Storm, and now Phoenix, and in blisteringly fast fashion, Immortals claim a 2-0 over Team Liquid. Dardoch gets himself a kill, sneaking in to get plowed down as well.
Yeah, Impact not enough to try and take this down. Team Liquid is going to charge forward and take down the Nexus. Cloud and 9 will finally fall as Team Liquid topple a giant to take the series.
Yeah, and C9 was looking so good last week.
It felt normal. It felt real.
Lola wants it. Sending Gnatic used to try and save him, but Lola's still there with the damage. Might just get it in the midst of it all, and Dardoch actually cleans up the back end.
Yeah,
now Sarah.
Yeah, I'm not nervous at all. I feel a lot better about the game. Well, just being on stage. Still gotta work on my play.
Will be a kill picked up. First blood goes over to Fabi. And the only recourse, the fact that
I'm
KFO gets to...
Great arrow goes to OQ. That gives them time to take down the AD carry. Hold off Liquid, the 2-0.
But then, like, the transition into LCS, like, I started seeing where my weaknesses lie. I didn't have any game knowledge. I'm learning more and more every week, though. I'm making my own calls, communicating with my team. Like, I've only been, like, in the LCS for 5 weeks, so... There's still so much improvement to be done, but it's definitely looking better right now rather than worse.
When I first talked to Piglet, it was like, I love playing on TLA. I actually feel like I have a voice. Like, it actually feels like they respect me and care about me and they want to play with me.
And he started getting kind of like, eh, I'm not really feeling this as much anymore. And so when I had my one-on-one with Piglet, it addressed that. You know, the gist of it was, Piglet, like, you're having a lot of issues with, like, communication. There must have been something that happened between weeks 4 and week 7, obviously, that made him just go from, I love this team, to, I just want to retire.
I mean, you know you're really good.
I'm good.
I know. So why not be a good player and a good leader? Right?
No, I'm not either.
I think you're a leader. I think you have what it takes. You're older than everyone on the team. Do you know that?
I'm just... I'm just player.
So I just addressed it as humanly as possible. And I just like this team like constantly makes sacrifices for you. If you're going to play on TLA, you have to understand, I don't think they're necessarily doing anything wrong with like the identity of like incorporating you into the team. You know, they didn't necessarily choose you to play with them because they had Fabi. You came into TLA and we made that accommodation for you, and we talked to the TLA members of that, and they decided to make their sacrifice knowing who you were as a player, but also just knowing who you were as a person. They wanted to play with you and they wanted to give you the environment that they thought you deserved.
And I know you're a good ass player, right? Like one of the best, if not the best AD carry in the world, right? Can you be the best teammate in the world? I think you can, but you have to make the sacrifice needed for that.
Shit.
Yeah, so I mean, a lot of it's attitude, right? Right? Do you think a lot of it comes down to attitude?
Yeah.
Okay.
If they bad, I don't care. Like, if they attitude good, I don't care. Even they, like, fucking bad team, even they, if they, like, just, like, challenge the team, and if they, like, just like shitty team, I don't care if they edit good, but if edit good, if edited bad, like I care so much, like my feeling so bad, cause like just I only care attitude. So yeah, I don't.
Right.
I'm like roster, right? Mm-hmm. After that, and then they just like change something, so I can't like fucking fix them.
Okay. You need to be able to talk, right? If you're upset, you still need to be able to communicate those things. Otherwise, he doesn't know what to do.
Like, if I'm upset, like, if I talk more, mm-hmm. like, I'm just more, I get more angry, mm-hmm. and more get upset. And that's just, boom.
No excuses. No, I just want you to promise me. Can you be strong? No, it's gonna be hard.
That's so hard. So I try, but I not 100%.
Okay, I want you to sit up and look at me, okay?
Okay,
I want you... No whining, don't say.
Uh-huh.
Stop it. Okay, sit up. Why don't you sit up and look at me? You are such a monkey.
A monkey? Jeez.
Sit up and talk to me. Sit up and talk
to me. Yo, you guys should... Yeah, send him, you know?
Sit up and talk to me.
He sent me. He sent me, monkey.
Cute monkey. Okay.
You guys think I'm monkey? Or maybe.
Okay, sit up and talk to me.
Oh, why? I don't want to see if I sit like.
I need you to sit so you can promise.
And so our conversation was kind of just a back and forth until he kind of, and I think you were there too, until he kind of realized and agreed. Yeah, I should give it another chance, and I should make more sacrifices for a team that's constantly been accommodating me and sacrificing for me.
You work and fix team attitude and atmosphere. Promise me that you will work on your attitude.
But sometimes I'm getting upset.
I know.
Maybe not sometimes, right?
Maybe a lot of times.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
I know.
A lot of times.
I know, but can you promise that you will work on
yeah,
it?
Yeah, I try, right? Okay, I can try it. Okay. Yeah, I try. Change my attitude and that. Like, but I just get upset too much. Like.
Right.
So, yeah.
That's why we bought you so many bottles of chamisu.
Oh, I should do it today. Oh,
alright, take it easy though, okay? Alright. Do you promise though? Yes?
Yes.
Okay, I promise I work with you too, okay? Okay? Alright, tomorrow.
I know that you have scrims and stuff, so...
Up top is the dive.
Oh, yeah, Moon dives. RF Legendary will go down. Ooh, Popper takes a lot, but so too, and takes the series 2-0 over Enix in a very commanding win. Team Liquid Academy have just secured the second...
We didn't have the best week of practice for sure, but really good way to end out the season. We have 6 days until playoffs.
Back in, and Team Liquid Academy are cleaning up with 3 kills, and they're not going for the dragon. They're heading towards the Baron. Team Liquid Academy 2-0 so far. Will go mid, knocks into a Blaze Olive for a lot of damage. First blood, Golden Glue. Ken hops over the Nexus, but the Nexus turrets are going down, and Team Liquid Academy will take the series and advance to the Challenger Series Finals.
We're a playmaking team. We either dominate them or we play slow, and it's not how we play. Look to dominate. Look to dominate. And we'll win this series. Okay, guys?
But he actually drops before getting the pull out. Equalizer tries to reset, but Cloud9 Challenger could be looking to take this game here and now. They drop
onto the Nexus turrets themselves. We're going to game three as Team Liquid Academy take game two over Cloud9.
He gets disappeared by Cloud9 Challenger as they pick up 4 kills. Solo, the sole survivor, will watch the Nexus fall.
Standing,
but they do not stand a chance. Team Liquid Academy even it up. And we are going to game five. He is going to be the pick. And Rammus.
What?
Hold the phone. Last second timer.
The North American Challenger Series Finals as they take the Nexus and defeat Team Liquid Academy.
Team Liquid Academy is going to have to play the 10th place team as well as the 9th place team in best of fives in order to qualify. So a much tougher road from them in that regard. But they can still do it, right? It is still in their own hands.
The thing with me and Sam's relationship is I'm in a high stress environment with my best friend, and I want to see him continue to be my best friend and also my coworker. So when Samson is severely underperforming as one of the worst top laners in North American LCS, I'm obviously going to tell him that I'm not gonna go off to him and be like, hey bud, you're doing a real great job out there. Keep it up. I'm gonna be like, yeah dude, you're shit. You gotta pick it up or you're gonna get fucking benched. And that's what I told him every time he underperformed. And he's come to me several times and said, thank you for making me the player who I am today. Samson's had tons of improvements, and he said he holds me responsible for a lot of his improvement. And if I could go back and talk to him differently, I tell him he's shit to his face every time I believe he's shit, and he always fixes it. There's a matter of harsh criticism, and there's a matter of people who take harsh criticism well, and I think Samson really adapted. I think hearing it from his close friend helped him a lot.
He's definitely like another brother to me. And in the past 8 months, he's changed me for better and for worse. Like, I poured my emotions into the team and to him. Like, yeah, we grinded things together. We worked on our problems together. We improved as a duo together.
Sassy? I don't know. Get that.
Nope. Dardoch thinks you're a
Someone messed up 2v1, I guess. I don't know.
Well, I mean, speaking of who would mess up a 2v1, Lorlo.
I don't know. What is that?
Actually,
I don't know. I don't know. I think just having someone to rely on, just like always have someone like, yeah, let's go to 7-Eleven together. Let's go to Cheesecake. Just have like the guy that I can go with somewhere without even like be stressed out around him, because like he knows everything about me. I know everything about him. So it's always nice to have someone that you honestly don't have to talk to him because you're just having a good time with him.
Who is this?
Schoolboy Q, dude. His new album. Sam's not even know who the fuck that is.
I have no clue who this is. Prince's white boy rapper.
He only knows Tupac.
Only knows Tupac.
That's my boy. That's all you got in that.
No Drake.
Me no
Kanye.
With the face.
That Pac.
Oh, I just want us to go crazy
today.
We
have to beat these guys 2v2. When have we lost to them?
Okay, we can't throw our lead.
You guys have actually never lost to them 2v2 opening of the game.
We never lose 2v2 to anybody.
Yeah.
We've got 6 months of synergy, dude.
6 months of in and IRL synergy. Nobody's closer than me and Sam.
I don't know if that's for better or worse.
Not even Darshan and X-Smithy, dude.
No, they're probably
that doesn't even count.
They don't really talk to each other.
That bot.
Do I tweet the picture of me and Sam and the caption is Apex is fucking free or what?
I'd say
He just tweeted, prepare your cheese.
Oh, you
which insinuates that they need to cheese us to
You've
win.
Already tweeted that?
It's important.
You already tweeted that, Sam? No, you don't shit talk people that are like easily worse than you.
You gotta
shit talk the better people.
Yeah, but they've shit talked us before.
Just look at
them. Just retweet their tweet and just be like,
fuck
free
that.
Pass.
I gotta make my own. I gotta hype up the match, you know?
Oh, yeah.
For us, I think we have a lot of things to work on still, and like we're all like still putting in a lot of work. And I think at the end of the day, Liquid will have like a really good shot at making it look so.
Playing it pretty
still
well.
Getting dove. There's ulti in. Ray gonna get taken down, and first blood goes to Dardoch.
Ooh, unlucky.
That's rough. Just out of the way, Shrimp not tanking enough, but that ulti might be enough. No, not there in time. Whereas the rest of Team Liquid have cut Apex off right down the middle.
Two levels, that is huge here in this jungle priority, and they're trying to force fights. He does get it. They're looking for the initiation.
Shrimp, big ulti finds Fevy and Mac. Huge win from Keen as well. They're comboing in an Apex. They find the miracle team fight. A 4-0 win. Shrimp going to be late, but Keen's down here as well. Apex looking to turn things around. Spear's going to miss, but the ulti's down. Huge amount of damage is special. Takes out Matt. There's one as well for Keen as he slays Dardoch and Lolo eats a spear for another.
No one's listening to my calls, and then it's a mix of just people trying to do their own thing.
Trying to get Fabi, and they will get him, but there's a good ulti. Lolo now the target special. Knocks him up as well, but Phoenix still alive, and now Apollo finally takes him out. Keen did dive, and Apex going to clean up another team fight.
What a series from Apex. No one would have expected them to take down Liquid, who this was supposed to be the easy match for Liquid. They're supposed to take this series, move on and fight C9 tomorrow, but Apex has other plans and keep their playoff hopes alive.
Certainly looking good as they'll take the Nexus in game 3 and collect the upset.
And there's probably a lot of things that everyone wants to say, and the same thing as always, right after we lose, there, if we don't have any replay, if we don't have anything, we just go like, oh, someone should have done this, someone should have done this, it becomes useless emotional arguing. We're gonna go do fan interaction, take a short break, go back home, go through the games. We can still get really ideal situation out of this. If C9...
No, we're locked in fourth, and then we actually have to play the game now. So, just stop. We just gotta...
Fans in two, okay?
Stop. Let's get good. Who cares with C9 at this point? We lost this game. Like, third or fourth, fifth, sixth, doesn't even matter. Let's just get good so we beat every team.
I don't know. It's just like, we either get good at playing the 5v5 game or we draft towards the fucking jungle 1v9. So I'm the only, like, real consistent player that we have right now. Like, everyone is really inconsistent. And we're just losing games straight up because we're drafting towards 5v5 and we don't have five strong members. Like, when I'm dealing, when I'm full fucking tank Rek'Sai dealing more damage than two fucking AoE carries, like, that's not acceptable whatsoever. Like, this is, like, it's actually just sad, dude. Oh, it's just, like, it's so fucking embarrassing.
All right, let's go through fans and then we can talk afterwards.
I'm not going to fans. I'm just chilling.
All right, I mean, we gotta do fan as a team. We can't just send four people out there.
You can send four people, but we've done it before.
Nah, I don't think it's a good idea. I think we should
go fans as a team. Being completely serious, like, I'm not in the mood to do fans right now.
We can just cancel school. Some teams, sometimes they have been there.
Nick, your call.
We send four people.
All right, let's go, gang.
Everyone else was too tilted, dude. They played perfect. Dardoch played perfect.
Oh, that's my mom.
Deserves out to be here.
Where's our team? I'm tilted. Hmm?
There's my family. She's right there.
She's right there.
We had the freest road to Toronto. All
we
did.
No, I absolutely fucking. We had last team. Week. We had a 2-0 last week.
We need to beat fucking Clown Apex and fucking Cloud 9.
Yeah.
And then we have fucking Envy and fucking semifinal. And then we just go to semifinals for free.
Yeah.
And we play
and
against a team that we beat in scrims all the time. Fucking Immortals. Like, what the fuck?
Yeah.
We legit had the freest run to finals ever.
Yeah. And I mean, we can take that frustration.
Even freer than last split. What the fuck?
No, absolutely. But we can take that and we can just look at the next 3 weeks and say, like, do we give up now and do we just look forward to the next split or do we try to
focus on just ignore the fact that we're focused too hard on wanting to win and maybe we're just not good enough to win. We never put that one out there. Are we good enough to be in this league? Do we deserve to be here? Is our skill high enough to be in this league?
I don't very often like sit down and talk directly with the players. A lot of the coaching staff manage and do that most of the time. So it's a little like different for the player to be like, oh wow, the owner's coming over to me and he's gonna have to have a talk with me right before the game starts. So I just wanted to get an idea of where his mindset was. Kind of reassure myself that he was going into the last week and he was ready to play.
You've been doing some things that haven't been great, right? You've been on LCS days in game, you've been kind of saying things that you shouldn't be saying during the game. That's not very good for like team morale. It's kind of hurting the way the players play the game, and we're not increasing our odds of winning because of that match, because of the things that you're saying in game. The coaching staff doesn't want to work with you. They feel like it's a really unprofessional, unhealthy work environment. Obviously, from a business standpoint, I'm paying all of their salaries, plus Loco's salary, plus your salary, plus like Piglet's salary that, you know, didn't want, you guys had your issue as well. I am investing a ton of money, so it's extremely costly for me to run a business where I'm investing into things and then they want to just like quit because of the environment that's being created. As a businessman, like, I can't do that. I can't put all that money and resources into something that's not working.
When it comes to dealing with Dardoch, I try to pick the battles the right way. I know a lot of times when he gets heated, talking to him is not going to work.
I think after like counseling and summer and all the things with Jordan and Loco and my time and then hiring an assistant coach and all this stuff, it's just not working.
All those things, they all did the opposite of help, actually. Like, talking to Loco definitely doesn't help. I think that the team environment is not just I hate that everything is just put right onto me, like, I'm
well, no, here's the thing. Listen, there are other things that are going on, trust me. Hey, don't say that to me. Like, at the very least.
You just, like, cut me off in the middle of the conversation.
No.
Like, in the middle of my point.
You kind of just have to let him mull over it and let off some steam, whether that's him, like, venting a little bit.
If you're gonna give me a bottom lane that's playing at like a diamond five level, that's absolutely unacceptable. And then you're coming to me telling me that my attitude's a problem when he's not even putting forth.
I think the degree of effort, yes, maybe that's
the degree of effort. And how am I supposed to meet that with? It's okay, guys. We can still win. It's okay, guys. They all underperformed. Fabi had a very small time where he was performing really well, and then he got complacent and lazy, and now look where he's at. He's getting smashed by Apollo and Xspecial.
Yeah, I think that there's definitely valid points to that. I think that we need to make greater strides. I don't think that you can say that I've made all this progress and now I get to then still have some issues in game. Like, I should hold you accountable to a higher standard so that at least the issues that we have, I don't have to worry about focusing my energy with you. Instead, your actions are making me put energy and resources into this when it could go somewhere else.
Yeah.
Okay?
So
why not become the best athlete, not just a better athlete than you were 6 months ago?
When you look at like the outside picture and you understand like the fucking weight of that game and that set yesterday on me especially, I want Worlds more than any player on this fucking team. I don't give a fuck who they are. I don't care about Local, I don't care about Phoenix. I want this more than anyone. I put forth way more effort. I put all my life into this. I fucking sacrificed so much. I left my normal life. I sacrificed school. I dropped out of fucking high school to move out here and play this video game professionally, and I expected professionalism and hard work from my teammates. And that set,
I expect the same thing.
If we win and we go 2-0, we 2-0 today, we're Worlds. Fucking bound for Worlds. No chance. And when I'm met with that level of play and all I say is that the game's over, that is, honestly, that's an A+, honestly, from my point of view, because what I wanted to say is I want to quit the game. I don't want to play on the stage with these underperforming players.
I love your passion, Josh. Honestly, I get it. You know, it gets me fired up. I love it, okay? The only things are in-game stuff, and we've got to make a better effort on some of this stuff. Let me handle the things with our bot lane, okay? And I'll put my effort there. I got it.
Okay, buddy?
I want nothing more than to win, but
I do too.
It just gets overwhelming sometimes.
All right, let's go.
Liquid hoping to forget it ever happened. Cloud9 one kill short of a perfect game to start their series against Liquid. The Nexus is going to get smashed. If they don't sign the fountain, they're going to get them all. The call not going to mean anything. Media's blocked in, says, don't you dare. I'm a fat man. And knocked it down. A 2-0, 36-minute game.
Like, we have the ability to buckle down if we all take it seriously.
You can be the Cinderella story.
We could
CLG was a Cinderella story last split, and there've been a lot of teams that go from fucking awful seeding and awful regular split and then just win the whole thing. So I think we can do it as well.
And just on think about days,
we take sets on
effort. The amount of effort you put in is the result we get. I feel like for every single one of you guys, when you guys didn't put in effort, you guys played like shit. And when you guys put in a lot of effort, you guys played well. I'm not talking about as a team, but as individual performance. Your performance directly correlates with your effort.
Yeah. And how seriously you take it affects it a lot.
That's good.
I mean, what's left on stage is how much effort you guys put in. Like, if you're proud of your performance, if you're happy with how much effort you put in, then you're gonna get the kind of performance that you deserve. And if you're disappointed on stage and if you have regrets, that means it has to do something with the effort you put in that week. Be honest with yourself and think about how much effort you put in and if you're really satisfied, and think about what you can change for playoffs.
So they know exactly what they want to do.
Okay.
And then we'll be fine. Anything you guys want to add?
Let's fuck shit up.
Yeah. Oh, biggest thing. I don't care what Reddit says. I don't care what Twitter says. This is not Solo versus KFO. This is not Piglet versus Keith. This is not
TLA versus Echo Fox.
Frogman versus Colton Glue, I guess. It's TLA versus Echo Fox, okay?
Got me.
I didn't think we needed it.
The big old. Big old. I have coffee, so be careful. No.
Why'd you call?
TLA
have
to run you.
1, 2, 3, TLA!
Ash, but Stunt follows up. Exhaust looking for first blood. Knockout teleport. Golden Glue gets it. Hard, meanwhile, misses the Fat Flash. He's going to try to turn it around, but five members of Team Liquid Academy participated out. Does not have the Mega Gnar Slam. Oh, he drops the wallop late. KFO under the turret is stunned. Solo kills. Solo comes up big there. Oh, that player cam. The flex there from Solo after the play. TLA, they're very confident in this match.
The second Drake is secured by
Echobox. Moon tries to engage the cask, separates them back. Piglet goes in, trying to drop the AoE. Big will be the first to fall. Solo misses the first stun, but finds the second. KFO teleports in, looking for stun in the back line, but cannot find it. As Team Liquid Academy are cleaning this fight up, KFO will get one kill in return. Boomerang lands, and the stun follows it up. They have caught him. That is a dead Soraka.
And that's just Stunt playing really well on that Taric. He didn't even flash on that first one. He got the flash out of Keith, and then the barrel from Moon to separate the Soraka is an interesting choice, because usually you want to get the AD carry back into your team, but he had full confidence that they were going to catch him after the boomerang landed.
And Piglet, oh, pops up just in time to get the kill. Now Froggen completes his teleport. So much regret.
He didn't know.
Down. Piglet is running for his life. Does Piglet have the plays? No, he does not. Froggen kills him. Moon is going to be the last person here. There goes the Void Rush, and it is not enough. Nothing to deal with the damage. And Echo Fox might have done it. They scare away the rest. Keith even dropping a bit of BM as he drops into the Nexus.
Really close series. It sucks a lot. And I know all of us signed here with one goal, and it was to win. And unfortunately, we didn't win enough. I'm truly sorry for that. Know that every single one of you has improved a lot. And no matter where your paths go, whether you stay with us or look to seek other options or whatever happens, I know that this was a stepping stone into reaching higher achievements for your career. I know a lot of you guys improved. None of your guys' careers are gonna go down from here. It can only go up from here. And again, I'm really sorry for today's loss. It really sucks. If you told me a year ago that Piglet would play in Challenger and enjoy it and want to play in Challenger, I would not believe you. He went from one game away from competing for the finals to playing in Challenger and really enjoying playing the game, having his teammates going for one goal. And I felt like Piglet's development was so much further along in him being a leader and him just being able to trust his teammates and be a full team player.
Dave is my friend and Dave is my coach. If I get stressed, like I just talk to him. I need this. So he just try picks. I'm just one Dave, talk to him, everything. Dave doing good.
Dardoch goes in, but he gets stopped by Smithy. Hui stuns two in the back line, and Darshan still coming in. Great ult there from Gragas. Hui's getting low. Phoenix does manage to take him down, but he is going to get the counter kill onto Phoenix. DLG still fighting forward. Lolo low. Two man ulti from Darshan's going to seal the fate of two more members of TL and
Fatty. Do not look for a perfect team fight. You guys aren't going to get the perfect team fight. You guys are going to get defend engaged with, and everyone's going to be on the same page. Dardoch and Sam know what kind of fights they want to look for, and we're just going to follow through on the engages, regardless of if you guys think that it's good or not, okay? The engagers are gonna fucking engage, and we're gonna follow through on the engage, and we're gonna fucking smash them because they're shit here at team fighting because they're garbage, okay?
Goes all the way in. Hui managed to tag him. Fabi, they will get him, but Darshan taking damage. Hui also getting jumped by Lawler, but CLG peel and managed to take him down. Nah has gone down. Phoenix flashes in looking for more. Firing away. CLG gonna start to go wild in the base of Team Liquid. Nexus, hopefully though, it's gonna go down. And a chaotic end to game two. CLG up 2-0.
I'm just, whatever. Just pick me whatever. Let's just fucking lose it.
Go off, but there's no orders to follow. Dardoch going back in again. Xmithy getting a tag for the rest of CLG's here. Stixay just crits his face off as Suhi gets an ulti out for a bit of burst damage. Jin's caught out. Matt's gonna die. Sivir now with a double kill. CLG bursting forward. Phoenix gets the ulti, but Stixay once more. There's the triple kill. Looking to chase it down. Lolo, nowhere good to run. Stixay, there's the quadra kill. Jin, the only one left alive with no flash. They can do it. CLG. Show that while Team Liquid's talent may be undeniable, their poise is unbreakable.
26 minutes in, that's gonna wrap it up here.
From the last game of the season to the start of the gauntlet, we had about 3.5 weeks in order to prepare for those matches, to give our last kind of shot in order to get into Worlds.
In a holistic team view, you want to make sure that the health and mentality of the other four players are up to snuff too. And so we made that decision with the other players in mind. We wanted to give them kind of room to excel without feeling like someone is breathing down their throat on every single mistake that they make.
We thought, okay, if we continue as is, and we've just had the recent result of the last 2 weeks, we go into the gauntlet, can we fix those issues over these next 3 weeks, or is it better to just kind of shake things up and try something completely new?
I was just like chilling at my computer, just playing Soul Key like back in the old days, I guess. So, and then I just messaged Josh, so I'm online, like, hey, what's up? And he's like, I'm off the team. He's, that's like, he just blatantly said that to me, like, wait, you're trolling, right? Cause he, I'm like, used to him just messing around with me, like, of course he has to be trolling, right? I'm like, really? Question mark? And he's like, no, I'm really gone this time. I'm like, okay. Yeah, after I went downstairs, he was just like playing solo queue like usual. I'm like, are you leaving tonight? He's like, yeah, okay. So like I asked him if he needed help packing. He said he already packed, and then I walked him out to the car. He met his new Echo Fox manager. That was pretty, that's probably one of the saddest days of my life, to be honest. After he left, it was about like 9 o'clock. I went up to the roof. I was just like messaging my girlfriend a little bit. I messaged my good friend named Ben. I was like talking about like everything. I also just messaged Nick. I messaged Loco, and then Loco came up and he just talked to me about the good but also the bad. And it was just a long night of definitely a lot of crying. Probably one of the most depressing, sad nights of my life. It was really, really hard.
Any offer I get is fortunate. Like, I'm blessed to get it, so I'm gonna take whatever I can get. And at the moment, all I had was Echo Fox. So I instantly went on board and tried to prove that I changed.
Let's try a really healthy environment where we bring in somebody that maybe doesn't really know how to play jungle in his role, but is the number one rank in North America on the ladder, obviously has a lot of mechanical skill. Can we teach him as much as we possibly can about the top jungle picks and kind of the rotational macro game over those 3 weeks, and let's see how he performs. In my head, I thought, probably a pretty good shot. So let's talk to Ark second and find out what his mindset is. It was to just make sure that we had a really productive 3.5 weeks leading into the gauntlet, rather than kind of more of the same issues that were existing between Josh and the coaching staff.
Back here to qualify our third and final team to Worlds. Team Liquid has kind of tempered expectations, while Envy is maybe getting a little bit of a boon from the fact that Team Liquid is in a bit of disarray.
Before all this stuff happened with like the roster changes, you would think that Liquid are the favorites coming into it. Now, Envy are definitely the favorites coming into it against Liquid. We have a substitute jungler who has never played jungle before professionally in any capacity. I mean, the guy, Ark Second, is number one on the ladder, but as a mid laner.
Ark Second is gonna make his debut. Flash, he could.
Doesn't go for the outplay. There's the auto attack. There's first blood. Ark Second is gonna show up. And it's gonna be nice for Liquid. They're the first kill coming through for the new jungle. No, they're gonna go back in for this one. Try to burn him down.
E3.
Wow, Liquid pulling the trigger.
Okay, you got it.
Nice, push away.
I'm pushing.
Nice, good shit.
Holy fuck, you're a beast.
Yeah, let's start. I think we can come all.
Right side. Yeah. I'm being ulted. Okay, server.
Nice.
Good job. Just push. All right, I'm pretty sure we just won the fucking game. Jin on dragon.
Okay, Phoenix, we can kill Cassidy. Okay, keep going.
I'm on mid. I'm gonna be on all range in five.
No flash, Malzahar. I'm coming to Malz. I can ult. Oh, he's dead.
Kibbert's behind us.
Look for Sarah.
Look, Kessin.
He has flash.
Kessin.
Sarah, Rek'Sai's on site.
Back up.
Keep running.
Come on, Sever.
Yeah, help.
Just as soon as he respawns into the chain CC and deja vu, Ark Second's gone as fast as name implies, and now Phoenix has to run away as his teammates are all dying around him. It's a 5v2 as Envy are going to look to close out the first game of the series in a pretty incredible comeback win. Seraph playing his 20th champion of the split, the Kassadin. Pretty instrumental in the win as Phoenix running out of HP. A quick trade kill comes in.
It's really obvious that after like 9 months of work that your emotions just build up to the last result.
No, it's not that. Only that just whole game. After all the game, they just shut down their mouths.
This is the last run we have for Worlds, and it was like the last tournament we had to play for like the end of the season. So even myself, like I had a ton of pent up emotion built up, and I know Phoenix did.
They don't have any plan, and they just, I don't know what, we just playing like fucking normal game.
Couldn't control him at the end and just lashed out on the new rookies and also just the team in general because he was frustrated that we couldn't even beat Envy, and like that's pretty disappointing for not only myself but for Liquid Org in general.
I think that it's really important that if you see people are shutting down and people aren't talking, you talk to them. You're like, yo guys, we can still win this, we can do this. And then you give them clear objective and clear plans on what they can do to execute if you think people aren't coming up with their own plans.
I can see his frustration, it's definitely acceptable, but after my 9 months of like hard work and just ending up getting 3 out, it's definitely like a heartbreaker.
If you don't want to be on Sivir, then we can use the last man on Sivir because he's willing to play Irelia into Kennen, and then you can be Jhin instead. Would you rather do that?
I mean, I can take Sivir too.
Which one would you prefer, Phil?
I don't really have a preference. Okay. I prefer Jhin over Sivir, actually.
Alright, then let's go with that, okay? Let's get ready to get on stage. And Phoenix, you stay. Phoenix, if you really want to win this series, instead of blaming picks, let's talk about what we can fix. And even if you do think picks are problematic, you can say it in a much more productive way.
Yeah, I say fucking picks problem. Mm-hmm. They just fucking, I just play fucking normal game. With voice chat, with some random guys. They just, after every game, they just do nothing. Oh, I do this, I do this. They just doesn't have any plan. They just fucking, just shut, they don't know what to do, they just shut down.
If they don't know what to do, then we can help them in game.
How I fucking say 5 men?
I think saying something simple like, yo guys, I want to get side lane priority, can you push up mid is something really helpful that you can tell them.
They just close your mouth.
Because I know you're frustrated and I know they're closing their mouths. Instead of us yelling at them, why aren't you guys talking? Like, you guys can do this really easily, like this is so simple, it doesn't really help the problem. But if you can talk to them where it's motivating and tell them what to do, and help them talk, I think that would be a better solution than being angry at them.
Not being angry at them, they... Okay, yeah, if they don't know, they if they say something, I can dead, but they just say nothing.
They are saying nothing because they don't know what to say, and also they feel a lot less comfortable on stage than you. You've been playing longer, and you're a better player, and you have more experience than them.
So I just make them just open their mouth.
I think you did a decent job of making them open their mouth, but we can even do a better job. We can put confidence in them instead of telling them, just talk, like, why aren't you guys talking? I think going with that approach is gonna shut them down more, especially Matt. I think Matt's the one that's having the hardest time talking. Matt not talking is from lack of confidence. So when we're angry at him and we're like, you can just say this, you should just say this, then it makes them more likely to talk less, not more.
Yeah, I know you just pick Bardock for giving confidence.
I gave the free choice of we can. I said either Trundle or Bard. It's up to you, Matt.
And you say Bard is fine. You know we like lose every Bard game and we have every.
Alright, we'll be right there.
We have every same problem every Bard game, but this is already seven, mm-hmm. seven times in a row.
I definitely agree, and I would much prefer Trundle, but Matt's not the type of player that can handle being told what to do, and he has to feel confident in it. There are certain limitations with certain players.
Alright, let's look for something. After Mega goes out, we engage, okay? That's what we're looking for.
So they're just gonna get three nims.
Yeah, and we can't defend. It's hard. We have to wait for Mega.
Right, hopefully we pull a Wild Turtle, get a Pentakill on Jinx.
Oh, I fucking see it. We have Phil Vu, baby.
We have Sidney me.
Free farm, let's go. Top lane is coming to us. I'm gonna go push out bot. They're back here right now. They're just gonna do Dragon.
Look for a camp.
I can ward Dragon. I'm not sure to kill me if I do this, but I'm going to go.
You're okay. Nice Wraith camps up.
from the final shot of Curtain Call. Lands in a fuse, but a great stun turns it back around. Still doesn't matter. They blow up the mid laner. The game-winning team fight. The match-winning team fight is here.
Oh, red's up.
Looks like all their summoners are up. Just gotta look for
my Zap does like
engage as soon as
they
can.
Oh shit, they're gonna go on me. Oh god.
Fighting Frost in jungle on jungle fight, but it just
nice. Alright, I have Titanic.
We see two of them in biz.
We're red on Jinx.
Right?
I'm coming. Alright, wait for Meganar, the same thing.
I
look at Mega Rage, okay?
But I don't think we can wait for it. We'll see.
Yeah, wait. If we can wait, then we wait. If not, we have to just go with Mega Fight.
Yeah, Flash.
Just watch Mega.
Flash.
We just gotta get
oh shit, yeah, we have to go. We have to go.
Come on, come on, come on.
Look, Cassio.
To fight their mortals
for a I flash. I'm going to Cassio.
I'm going to Cassio. Guess.
I'm looking at Jin.
I'm flashing, yeah.
Come on, Gragas.
Did you get him?
I'm being slowed. Well, that's game.
Hey, man.
You.
The situation we were given was definitely a hard one. Like, going into Gauntlet versus teams that have been playing together for almost the entire split. With two rookies, one with role swap. I think the expectations we set for ourselves, we, in scrim, sometimes we met them, sometimes we didn't. Our environment was good, our environment was bad, but we always put in effort. And I really like that everyone, like, even in like the darkest times where we lost Dardoch, we lost Piglet, like we're still fucking working at it, people aren't giving up. We scrimmed more in the last week than we ever did on a regular LCS week. We played more games per average per day, we reviewed more per day, we watched more clips per day, we reviewed more bots in the last 2 weeks than we did. And I did think we showed a lot of progress in terms of where we were and where we ended at. Results are definitely disappointing for everyone. I don't want you guys to beat yourself about it, but I don't also want you guys to be satisfied with like what we accomplished, because to be honest, we didn't accomplish a lot this split and not a lot this year. And overall this split, like, I'm not satisfied with the results, but from the rookies, or from every player, I've been pretty satisfied with your growth and how much effort everyone put in. All right, let's go do fan interaction.
One last one.
For the Rebirth, for the Rebirth.
Okay.
One last one.
James, do it.
Come here.
One last one.
Okay.
Go get in here.
Come here, lemur.
On three, one, two, three.
Liquid.
I'm happy with some of the progress I've made in the jungle, but then like as actually a team, like all that matters is winning, and we didn't get to, it would have been great if we could have actually tested how far we came against C9 or, yeah, or Immortals, but so a little disappointed that we didn't get to quite see our growth or quite get where we wanted to be.
I'm overall glad that I did get to play with Liquid, but I do wish it went differently and like situations were different. And I just, yeah, I can't even imagine like what Team Liquid fans feel because of all the messes that's been happening. And I just want to say like sorry for my performance and hope I can get a chance to prove myself again.
Pretty much just learn how to be more involved in like the direction that, you know, team has to go in. Like, I just need to be more involved. I have to work harder. And that's kind of just the lesson that I get. If you want to have good control over your own destiny, you need to actually give a shit.
And I'm doing better than ever. So I'm like really glad, and I respect the organization a lot, and they've done a lot for me. So I can't really say anything bad about them. They've done more than good for me, so.
My first moment is when Figure going TLA. I should say I'm retired too, because I feel like don't hope anymore. So that will be changes something. I don't know, I just want to play with who can be reigning, and who can be talk, and who can be practicing. Yeah, that's all.
I would take the individual happiness of one of my players to take like sixth place in a split and have the entirety of Liquid fans and the entirety of the Reddit community just trash an organization. I'm fine with that because I don't have a professional relationship with Reddit. I don't have a professional relationship with Team Liquid fans. I have a professional relationship and genuine care for the individuals that I interact with on a daily basis. So I made myself into the person I am because I worked my ass off and I had values that I've stuck to for all of my life.
We came to agreement on how much we'll be spending, how much structure is going to be implemented, how many resources are going to be poured into our LCS team's performance. And we are all very excited about that. The biggest thing will be that they're going to do everything that they can on the management side, and we're going to do everything that we can to perform. The roster that we're potentially looking at is something that will be very exciting. I honestly believe that we will be a championship contending team next year. I'm ready to lead that.
What's up, dude? Can you play me?
1, 2, 3.
That's my champ. That's my champ. 3303489.
My biggest regret in my career so far was how I acted towards and how I treated Piglet. Where, like, I mean, I saw him as like my older brother, and he looked out for me all the time and tried to make me the best player that I could be. I tried extremely hard to get him to his first NA Finals and tried to make him an NALCS champion like he always wanted to, no matter how bittersweet it would have been if he finally got his goal and, you know, he would have left after NALCS champion and went off to play in Korea or whatever. Like, I wanted that for him. And it's an awful feeling because everyone depicts us as enemies, and I really want nothing more than to prove them all wrong and to be his friend again and to be his teammate again and help him win. And yeah, it just feels awful because I feel like I let him down, I let the org down by, you know, mistreating him after I made promises to change my ways and be more respectful of him and Loco.